Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dream Golf, The Making of Bandon Dunes, revised and expanded by Stephen Goodwin, narrated by Dan Calley. Introduction. Ever since it opened in 1999, Bandon Dunes has been one of the stories in golf, an improbable tale that got better with each telling. On a remote stretch of the Pacific coast, at the edge of beyond, a golf course had appeared, and not just an ordinary course, but a seaside course of great drama, purity, and beauty. Early visitors to the place came back with stars in their eyes, claiming to have discovered a true American lynx. Golf Week ranked Bandon Dunes as a top 100 course before it had officially opened. Golf Magazine had never run a picture of a golf course on its cover, but it ran a picture of Bandon Dunes. Sober, thoughtful golf writers declared the place to be inspirational, comparing it to Pebble Beach in California and Ballybunion, the fabled Irish lynx. Standing joke. What's the difference between Bandon Dunes and Ballybunion? Answer. It's easier to get to Ballybunion. Golfers wanted to know everything they could learn about this place that seemed to defy all conventional wisdom. From the point of view of the golf industry, Mike Keiser, the owner and developer, had done everything backward. He'd built a resort that was nowhere near any kind of market. He'd built a golf course that was deliberately and proudly designed not as a contemporary course, but as a throwback. He'd ignored advice to hire a name architect and chosen instead a young, unknown, inexperienced Scotsman, David Kidd. He had also decreed that the course would be for walkers only. He kept it free of carts, cart paths, and real estate. He was never tempted to make the course private. He wanted it to be open to the public and to be priced so that locals could enjoy it. People warned him that he was throwing his money away, but Mike Keiser trusted his dream. He believed that other golfers were searching for the same things that he sought in a golf experience. And he was right. Bandon Dunes touched a nerve. The course soared into the upper reaches of the course rankings, and then, in 2001, its sister course, Pacific Dunes, designed by Tom Doak, a youthful and controversial American golf course architect, opened to even more glowing reviews. It was another lynx course, and, some said, was more authentic, more beautiful, and more captivating than the first. With two courses, Bandon Dunes, a name that came to encompass the resort itself as well as the original course, moved into select company. The list of golf sites that can claim dynamic duo status is short, wrote Jamie Diaz, one of the most respected writers in golf, in Travel and Leisure Golf. His list was a roster of golf's holy places: the Monterey Peninsula, with Pebble Beach and Cypress Point; Shinnecock Hills and National Golf Links, the two tracks at Winged Foot; Olympic Lake and Ocean; Ballybunion Old and New; St. Andrews Old and New; Pinehurst Numbers 2 and 8. How did Bandon Dunes and Pacific Dunes rate in this elite company? I'm convinced, Diaz wrote, it won't be long before Bandon and Pacific, given their public accessibility, unspoiled environment, dramatic setting, thoughtful design and true golf spirit, are considered the best tandem of courses in the world. The best in the world. Strong words. Especially considering that all the other places listed by Diaz have been steeped in tradition. Golf is not a sport that readily embraces the new, but reserves judgment and comes to decisions in its own sweet time. Was it possible that a pair of brand new courses in Bandon, Oregon, could eclipse the time-honored favorites? Yes, it was. Visitors to Bandon experienced a classic coup de foudre, a blow of passion, love at first sight. This was the kind of golf of which people dreamed, golf that lifted the spirits and brought a renewal of gusto and energy. At the rim of the continent, against the colossal sweep of the Pacific Ocean, people seemed to rediscover the game and to remember what made it so majestic and exhilarating. Bandon hadn't been the site of any notable tournament, nor was it associated with any of the big names in golf. It had won its place by a kind of popular acclamation. Not to stretch the point too far, but Bandon seemed almost like a shrine where something miraculous was said to have occurred, a remote place to which pilgrims found their way, hoping to partake of the mystery, hoping to breathe in the sacred energy. The Bandon story kept evolving, and so did the place. A third course, Bandon Trails, designed by Ben Crenshaw and Bill Corr, opened in 2005. A few of its holes were located in high dunes, but most of the golf course was routed through meadow and dense forest, opening new vistas and revealing new dimensions of the property. Golf writers hailed Bandon Trails as another treasure, and Bandon Dunes moved into an even more exalted category. The story still wasn't over. The buzz that had surrounded Bandon Dunes for a decade kicked up a notch with the announcement of a fourth course, Old Macdonald, opening in 2010. The course was conceived as a tribute to Charles Blair Macdonald, and the name, with its playful twist, served notice that the course would be inspired by classic principles of design, but would not be a solemn lecture in golf history. It also signalled that Mike Keiser was willing to vary the pattern. Instead of turning to a designer for an original course, he'd named Tom Doak and Jim Urbina as co-designers of Old Mac and complimented them with an advisory panel. The goal was still an original course, but this was a much more collaborative arrangement. And since the idea had originated with him, Mike Keiser had edged a little more into the spotlight. Golfers are recharged at Bandon. In the course of writing this book, I spent a lot of time there, and I saw how many people came up to Mike Keiser to thank him for building the golf courses. They were strangers, but they wanted to let him know how much they'd enjoyed playing at Bandon Dunes, and they wanted to express more than mere enjoyment. They wanted him to know that their experience had mattered. Mike responds to these strangers sincerely and graciously, but he always seems slightly embarrassed to be recognized as the owner of the place. He doesn't have an ounce of pretension in him. He is the visionary who had the imagination, the patience, the money, the sheer guts to bring this place into being, and he knows what he has created. He doesn't crow about it, but his feelings do show themselves every now and then, as they did one day at Bandon Dunes while Mike played around with an old friend. I was tagging along, and at the 12th hole, a par 3, we had to wait for a few minutes while the group ahead played out. The ocean was glittering in the afternoon sun, and Mike was talking about the storms that lashed this stretch of the coast in the 1850s. The huge waves had washed away the deposits of gold-laden black sands on the local beaches, putting an end to Bandon's brief gold rush. "They say we're due for more big storms," Mike said. "Sometimes I wonder how much of the golf course it might take away. That would be a tough call for a golf course owner, wouldn't it? Suppose you were offered a choice. You could save your golf course or your life. Which would you do?" Then he gave a small, self-conscious laugh, knowing he'd revealed the depth of his attachment to the place he'd created. Mike, the practical businessman, had said in so many words that Bandon Dunes was his legacy. This book is about Mike Keiser and his pursuit of a dream. It is about the golf courses at Bandon and the men who designed and built them. Men who had dreams of their own. Dreams that converged with Mike's. It is about the way that these golf courses built on a remote stretch of the Pacific coast were able to capture golf's ancient magic. Part 1. A Man with a Program. 1. Soul Work. Deep down, I wanted to build something that would last. I wanted to build a golf course that people would be playing 500 years from now. Mike Keiser. In 1985, Mike Keiser acquired 60 acres of wooded sand dunes in New Buffalo, Michigan. His immediate goal was to prevent a developer from building condos across the road from the lakefront home where Mike and his wife Lindy spent weekends with their young children. New Buffalo is a resort town on the southeastern tip of Lake Michigan, a 90-minute drive from downtown Chicago. For the Keisers, who lived and worked in the city, the place seemed idyllic and remote, the perfect place to escape for quiet, unhurried family weekends. Mike regarded the acquisition of the 60 acres as a defensive purchase. As a partner in a flourishing company, Mike was able to pay cash for the 60 acres. He and Lindy were co-founders of Recycled Paper Greetings, along with his college roommate, Phil Friedman. And they had seen their enterprise expand from a tiny startup with offices in their two-room apartment into a business that was generating annual sales of roughly $100 million. Launched on Earth Day in 1971, Recycled Paper Greetings was known for its environmental awareness and its witty, irreverent greeting cards. From the start, RPG's cards had offered an alternative to the more traditional, sentimental greeting cards produced by Hallmark, and the company quickly grew into the third largest in the industry. Still privately owned, RPG has been a bold, gutsy, original venture, and it made Mike Keiser a rich man. It also taught him to trust his business instincts. Those 60 acres of sand dunes gave Mike a kid with a new toy feeling. He'd been considering various golf investments, and he was serious enough to have looked hard at a large tract of land near Washington, D.C. as a potential golf course site. Now, with a chunk of property to fuel his imagination, he was like, say, Ben Hogan with his first golf club. He'd come into the possession of something that brought his long simmering interest to a full rolling boil. At first, he treated the property as a family playground, and he'd stroll over with Lindy and the children, all of them carrying golf clubs and pockets full of old balls to play wilderness golf, pick a tree and find a way to hit the ball to it. The sandy, scruffy site reminded him of Pine Valley, the renowned golf course in New Jersey to which he'd made many pilgrimages. Geologically, this whole section of the Lake Michigan shore belonged to an unusual dune belt. Most of the land was wooded, covered with stands of oak, maple, sassafras and cottonwood, but there were openings where the family could play full-throttle golf shots. The most remarkable feature of the site was a ridge 50 feet high, a veritable mountain in the flattish lake country that seemed to cry out for use in a golf course. The more he got to know his 60 acres, the more Mike envisioned golf holes with tees situated on the high ground of the ridge, creating dramatic downhill shots to fairways and greens fitted among the dunes below. Mike Keiser, a lifelong golfer, was also an armchair golf course architect. For years, his bedside book had been a thick volume with pictures and descriptions of the top 100 courses, and whenever he could steal away for a day or two, he'd visit places on the list, places like Pine Valley and Merion. He knew that he'd never be a scratch golfer, but his score wasn't the measure of his satisfaction in the game. On his own property, he was happy to crisscross the dunes with a golf club in his hand, whacking old balls from one dune to the next as he imagined how golf holes might be fitted into the contours of the land. Mike couldn't stay away from the dunes. Even when his family couldn't get away for the weekend, even when he might have chosen to play golf, he'd drive out to New Buffalo with his friend Howard McKee, the two of them wearing jeans and work boots and carrying lopping shears and axes. They'd crawl through the wire fence, there was no entry road into the property, and spend hours cutting brush. Their specific mission was to rid the property of the grapevines that grew luxuriantly, slowly smothering the trees to which they attached themselves. Their broader mission was to let certain life questions evolve and percolate as they busied themselves with physical labor. Mike and Howard had gotten to know one another as fathers of children who happened to be in the same elementary school class, and in some ways, they were an odd couple. Mike was a golfer, an athlete, an entrepreneur accustomed to operating independently and swiftly. Howard was professorial in appearance and manner, a trained architect and land planner whose career with the international firm of Skidmore, Owings and Merrill had involved him in hugely complex undertakings. The kinds of projects, like building cities in Saudi Arabia, that required volumes of planning documents and years of patience to bring to fruition. Moreover, while Mike inclined to the right politically, Howard leaned toward the left, but the two found that they both enjoyed their spirited intellectual sparring. The brush-cutting sessions were enlivened by debates about economics, education, and environmental issues, about which they had strong and often opposing opinions. The personal undercurrent was always there, too. Howard had come to Chicago to take part in the planning for the 1992 World's Fair, Conceived as a centennial celebration of the 1893 fair, it actually opened in 1892, generally regarded as the most successful World's Fair of all time, the fair that brought together the forces and energies that created the modern city of Chicago. By 1987, it was obvious that the centennial fair wasn't going to happen, and Howard was watching 3 years of work go down the drain. He was thinking of a career change. In certain moods, he was ready to consider radical changes, like returning to Oregon, the place he'd once lived and still regarded as his spiritual home, and spending a few years rereading the great books. "I was ready to leave Skidmore, Owings and Merrill," he says. "I'd gotten to the point where I needed to do something that mattered to me in very direct, immediate ways. I knew that I needed to do what I considered soul work." Soul work. Mike didn't describe his own restlessness in those terms, but it was clear to Howard that Mike was ruminating about his own future. Mike was 40 years old when he purchased the New Buffalo Tract, an age often associated with midlife changes. He'd taken part in an armchair architect contest sponsored by Golf Digest, and he actually believed he had a chance to win it. Moreover, he was close to making a decision to indulge his golf course obsession, and it was becoming an obsession, by building a course on his 60 acres. The property wasn't big enough for 18 holes, not even for 9 holes, but Mike had started looking at adjacent properties that would give him enough land. Not a golfer himself, Howard didn't entirely understand the hold that the game had on Mike's imagination, and he wasn't quite sure what Mike had in mind when he spoke about more ambitious golf projects that could go well beyond what he was contemplating here in New Buffalo. In the fall of 1987, Mike and Howard went out for one of their regular neighborhood dinners with their wives. The family friendship had actually begun when Lindy and Howard's wife Kennan became acquainted. The conversation turned toward the difficulties Mike was having in finding a suitable piece of golf land on the East Coast, and he asked Howard if he could help him find something out west. After all, Howard had spent a lot of time in Oregon and was looking to spend more. By this time, Howard knew Mike fairly well, but he couldn't quite gauge the seriousness of his proposal, and he made the request that any architect would make. He asked Mike to put together a program that listed his requirements and desires for the property he sought. A few weeks later, Mike handed Howard a couple of handwritten pages. This was his program, and when Howard read it, he was taken aback. In fact, he was tempted to laugh. He knew that Mike was a successful businessman and a big thinker, but he had no idea that the man who'd been wriggling through the fence on his hands and knees, spending the day lopping grapevines, was formulating a scheme on such an epic scale. The program called for oceans, waterfalls, and breathtaking beauty. It contemplated the appropriation of a small town. It dealt in sums of money that were significant, especially when the money were becoming straight out of Mike's pocket. It seemed almost to have been written in haste, in a telegraphic style with all fluff eliminated, making the scope of the project seem even more stark and audacious. The program read like this: minimum 1,000 acres, best minimum 5 to 10,000 acres, land budget $10 million. Location, initially California, Oregon, preferably on coast or with some coastal access. Would not exclude Monterey South in first pass. Sandy soils, sand dunes on at least part. Standalone water, rivers, streams, lakes, waterfall, i.e. unusual features a prerequisite. If parcel is large enough, could include a small town. Regardless proximity, 20 miles to town or larger with potential. Parcel cannot be flat, further it must be breathtaking. Year-round or near-year-round outdoor climate. Sympathetic ecosystem. Diversity of environment. Go or no-go within 6 months. Staged development thereafter at a planned expenditure rate of maximum $3 million a year for 10 years. Minimum amenities. 1. 18-hole championship golf course with extraordinary unique features, sand dunes, waterfall, etc. 2. Room for 2 more golf courses. 3. Tennis. 4. Clubhouse. 5. Guest cabins, lodges. 6. natural easy access to national forest. 7. Natural easy access to canoeing, whitewater canoeing, mountain and rock climbing, windsurfing, fishing, fly, deep sea fishing, bicycling, jogging, hiking, etc. For Howard McKee, a man who'd felt constricted and confined in his work, this program was the wild blue yonder, and once he overcame his initial surprise, he didn't waste any time coming to a decision. Within a few days, he'd drafted a careful response to Mike's program, outlining a systematic approach to finding a tract of land that would meet the requirements and setting his own fee at $3,000 per month. By return mail, he received a countersigned contract and a check for his first month's fee. Drawn on an account that Mike had set up for his golf expenses, the check didn't have the usual kind of identifying information. Mike's name wasn't on it, nor was there any address or phone number. The title of this account was simply Shivas Irons, the name of the mystical hero of Golf in the Kingdom, the legendary golf book of Michael Murphy, a founder of the Esalen Institute. Mike had misspelled the name. The character in the book is Shivas with an S, and he used Shivas with a C, as in the Scotch whiskey. Here was a powerful coincidence. Howard, though not a golfer, had not only read Golf in the Kingdom, but had also been a frequent visitor to Esalen. He had been hired to redesign the property in the early 1980s and had become a good friend of Michael Murphy's. Indeed, Howard believed less in coincidence, that is, in the randomness of events, than in synchronicity. He was inclined to see meaning and purpose when events had links and connections. This appearance of Shivas Irons at the outset of the project was at the very least a piece of serendipity. It was a good omen. Howard McKee saves everything, and he placed Mike's handwritten program in a file folder. When he dug it out 16 years later, he had to laugh again at the audacity of the list, even though Bandon Dunes fulfills just about every one of the original requirements. The only thing missing is the waterfall. 2. The Anti-Tycoon. Mike Keiser spends less on his clothes than Donald Trump spends on his hair. Josh Lesnick. Even though Mike Keiser has become a significant figure in the golf world, he continues to oversee the operations of Recycled Paper Greetings along with Phil Friedman. Mike still chooses all of the product, and RPG produces 8,000 items per year, including 3,000 new items, and he and Phil still share an office, literally. Their desks are not more than 10 feet apart in a large room with beige carpets, fluorescent lights, metal filing cabinets, and piles of stuff everywhere. Phil's desk area resembles that of a stressed-out graduate student with its sprawling trails, mounds, ridges, and cordilleras of clutter. Mike's space, by comparison, is a model of order and tidiness, and his many piles of paper are neatly stacked. Framed pictures of his family hang on the walls, along with a few golf pictures. All in all, this office could be described as comfortably lived in, and it's clearly the lair of partners who are way past worrying what anyone else might think of their working arrangements. In articles in golf publications, Mike has been described as a tycoon and the greeting card mogul, terms that are wildly off the mark insofar as they suggest a man who projects wealth and power. He has no interest in the various trappings of corporate structure that would bolster his image or ego. He avoids flash and ostentation. He goes to work in casual, comfortable clothes, khakis or corduroys usually, and a freshly laundered and pressed Oxford shirt without tie. His assistant for 15 years, Karen Thompson, knows that he has an off-site meeting when he shows up in jacket and tie. His title, she says, is flexible. Mike has cards that designate him variously as chairman, president, and vice president, though he prefers to be untitled. When Phil and I incorporated, a little lawyer insisted that one of us be president. We told him that we'd like to be known as the Baron and the Duke, and of course he thought we weren't serious businessmen. We were quite serious, though, about the ability of a title to create a rift when two partners are co-equal, and we've always avoided that. When the Chicago streets are wet or slushy, Mike steps out of his shoes and pads around the office in his stocking feet. Even shoeless and tieless, however, he manages to appear slightly overdressed and out of his preferred element. He has the open gaze and deep, permanent sunburn of a man who's spent his best hours out of doors. Just a touch under 6 feet tall, he keeps himself fit and trim and spends his lunch hour jogging or working out at a nearby gym. He weighs the same 150 pounds as he did when he graduated from college. He likes participatory sports, especially individual sports, skiing, tennis, golf, but has next to no interest in spectator sports. He rarely goes to games unless one of his children is playing. He has large features, a thatch of steel grey hair, and blue eyes that are remarkably clear and unwavering. Some people feel unsettled and disconcerted by the way Mike fixes attention on them, as though he is noting their every gesture and taking their precise measure. He seems remarkably free of self-consciousness. He doesn't fill the air with small talk or nervous distractions. He has the gift of authority, for it is clear that he says only what he means to say, not more, not less. He uses words with precision and accuracy, and his working vocabulary includes words like eleemosynary, diaphanous, and monetized. His voice is a baritone, and he enunciates with a clarity that would please any speech teacher. The guys who worked for him at Bandon had a field day imitating the deep, measured cadence of his voice. His inflection rarely varies, though he sometimes slips into a different key, dry, droll, and ironic, when he wants to poke fun or make a pun. He is good at puns. Everyone who's worked with him quickly comes to recognize his habits and style. For starters, he is absolutely not the kind of boss who makes work. He hates to waste time. He does not stand on ceremony or insist on protocol. His letters and memos are legendary for their concision and brevity. If he can avoid writing a complete sentence, he will, and his preferred method of written communication is the Post-it. Lately, his favorite Post-it bears a picture of the American flag, but before that, he was partial to a Post-it that carried these words of Dan Quayle's. What a waste it is to lose one's mind, or not to have a mind that is being very wasteful. How true that is. He addresses problems the minute they arise. He expects things to begin and end on time, and he is always punctual. He is practically allergic to meetings, at least those with a fixed agenda, but he enjoys free-form brainstorming sessions. He operates entirely in the present, giving his full attention to whatever is in front of him. He has a cell phone, but rarely turns it on. Though he bristles with physical energy, so much so that he has a hard time sitting still. In photos, Mike's image is often blurry because he is always moving. He rarely appears to be in a hurry. He has time to listen carefully to others. Jim Seeley, a business associate, says, "Mike is a master at eliciting the opinions of others and reconciling different perspectives." As an executive, he is emphatically not a micromanager or control freak, but, on the contrary, an overseer whose instinct is to grant the greatest possible freedom and latitude to those working for him. He likes the creative, conceptual aspects of business and the energy that flows from successful collaboration. He doesn't like plans that bind him, Howard McKee says. He'd much rather keep things open. He likes the razzmatazz. Yet when the moment comes, he is decisive. He is willing to take risks and to take responsibility for them. He doesn't make a show of this, but his colleagues always know the buck stops with Mike. He is comfortable with being the boss. His role at RPG, one friend speculates, has reinforced his habits of decision-making. He sees so many ideas for greeting cards and makes so many decisions every working day that he can't afford to be ambivalent, and he gets quick feedback about the soundness of decisions. He's a publisher, says Chris Ogden, a friend who's known Mike for years, and he has to decide quickly what will work and what won't. Every card has to tell a story in a hurry. There's a setup and a payoff, and Mike wouldn't be where he is now if he didn't have a gift for recognizing the good stories. Beyond those everyday decisions lie the large strategic visions. His business partners and associates are unanimous in praising his steadiness and clarity of vision. He is tenacious. Alfred Hamilton, a longtime friend and for many years a manager at RPG, believes Mike has a deep reservoir of confidence. He expects things to work. Howard McKee says, Mike has a unique ability to set a goal and to make everyone working for him feel that they have an essential part to play in the story. He makes them feel that the goal can't be achieved unless they make it their goal too. Josh Lesnick was only 29 when he became the first general manager of Bandon Dunes. "I should have been terrified," he says, "but Mike made it seem easy. His whole attitude was, 'We can do this.' I never got any vibe of stress or panic. We talked on the phone every day, and he never seemed worried. He always made me feel that I was doing okay, and I wanted to do better than that. I knew Mike had taken a risk, a big risk, and I really wanted to help him pull it off. He has that effect on people." Mike never doubted that he would go into business. His father, a World War II pilot and winner of the Navy Cross, was a stockbroker. His grandfather was a schoolteacher who changed careers and became a prominent banker in Binghamton, New York. Mike, the oldest of four brothers, was born on May 25, 1945, and raised in the town of East Aurora, not far from Buffalo, in a household where business ideas and principles were in the atmosphere. As much a part of his family's heritage as their Presbyterian morality and his father's strong sense of stewardship. His idea was the simple, old-fashioned idea of taking care of things, and he wanted to leave everything a little better than he found it. That's the creed I've tried to live by too. In addition, the senior Keiser was an avid outdoorsman, not a golfer, but a hiker, camper, canoeist, fisherman, and mountain climber, who led his brood into the woods on annual summer holidays to the Adirondacks. From him, Mike inherited his lifelong passion for the open air, a reverence for nature, and a concern for the environment. From his mother, who grew up in Ridgewood, New Jersey, and played her golf on the famed Ridgewood course designed by A.W. Tillinghast, he inherited his fascination and talent for the game of golf. Together, his parents instilled in him a set of habits and values that have lasted a lifetime. They equipped him with the confidence that is so often the birthright of the eldest child, and they set the needle of his moral compass at true north. Young Mike was a bright student and good athlete. At an early age, he learned tennis and golf at the East Aurora Country Club, and he has idyllic memories of endless summer days when life was pure and simple, consisting only of blue skies, green grass, golf shots, and delicious hamburgers. The golf course was tight and hilly, a sporty course for a club whose members didn't give themselves airs. For years after their course was built, East Aurora golfers carried buckets and screwdrivers as they played so that they could remove the stones from the greens. By the 1950s, the greens were stone-free, but East Aurora remained an unpretentious sort of place, where a young member might play golf one day and the next day pick up a few bucks as a caddy. Mike did both, and took pleasure in both. His childhood impressions of the game had an elemental simplicity, uncluttered by any sense of privilege, and to this day, he has a soft spot in his heart for caddies. He was also fascinated by the challenge of selling things, and his first business venture was in real estate, so to speak. He sold memberships in a treehouse club. He was beginning to put together a sense of himself that included many strands: golfer, salesman, steward, but in his own mind he was, perhaps most importantly, a maverick. On Sunday nights throughout the 1950s, he parked himself in front of the TV to see Maverick, his favourite show, and to follow the adventures of his hero, the cool, decisive, unflappable loner who went his own way, but nevertheless adhered to a strict code of honour and justice. When his parents decided to send him to the Nichols School, the leading private school in Buffalo, he felt like an outsider, the kid from the sticks, the one whose father had to drive for an hour to deliver him to any special event. Classmates remember him as a smart, popular, social boy, but inwardly, Mike was always on his own, always looking in, always a maverick. The class of 1963 was, Mike believes, one of the most successful in the history of the Nichols School, sending many of its graduates to Harvard, Yale, Princeton, and other top colleges. Mike went to Amherst. It was one of the few colleges, he says dryly, with a golf team bad enough for him to make. He got off to a rough start when a green dean suspended him in the winter of his freshman year. His offense, throwing snowballs. With $100 in his pocket, he set off to Europe, an adventure that paled quickly as he found out how hard it was to scrape together enough money to eat. He was 18 years old, and he was flat broke when he reached Paris where, thanks to a connection of his mother's, he was able to get a $2-a-day job. He stuck it out for a couple of months before using his return ticket, having learned that he didn't much like bumming around. He successfully petitioned Amherst to readmit him and to allow him to graduate with his entering class. Two summers later, fired up by reports of high-paying jobs, he set out for Alaska with a group of friends. The reports turned out to be exaggerated, and Mike and his pals were reduced to knocking on doors in the wealthy suburbs of Anchorage, looking for yard work. One moment stands out in Mike's memory. The leader of our little band was a guy named Eddie Lucaire. He was tall, athletic, good-looking, but when the woman opened the first door we knocked on, he froze. He couldn't say a word. He just stood there. So I had to step up, and I think I decided there and then that I didn't want to depend on anyone else. I became the leader. We did pretty well that summer, as it turned out, doing landscape work for $3 an hour. I came home with $1,200, which wasn't bad in 1965. At Amherst, Mike majored in English for the usual reason. He couldn't figure out what else to major in. By his own account, he was less focused and less driven than many of his classmates, and he hit the books just hard enough to maintain his standing in the dead center of his class. I was amazed to do that well. There were smart people at Amherst. He did play college golf and kept his handicap down in the single digits. One of his teammates, Tom Sturges, remembers that he and Mike were also rans on a team with one or two strong players. Politically, he often felt out of step. The years he spent at Amherst from 1963 to 1967 were tumultuous ones, with political lines sharply drawn. Abroad, the country was committing more and more troops to the war in Vietnam. At home, there were riots and marches. In the fall of his senior year, Mike was one of the few people in his Amherst class who was gravitating toward the military. That same fall, he met a freshman from nearby Smith College. Her name was Rosalind Kerm, and she was known to everyone as Lindy. A tall, graceful brunette, she had the looks and bearing of a model, but she was hardly a social butterfly. Her manner was private and reserved. She came from an intellectually distinguished family. Counting among her immediate forebears an internationally known grammarian and several prominent chemists, her mother was one of the original quiz kids and had supported herself and her mother, Lindy's grandmother, with her earnings from regular radio appearances. Lindy's parents had met in graduate school and they moved to Rochester, New York, where they started a family and began their careers. It was unusual for young mothers to hold jobs, but Lindy's mother was unconventional. She was a college teacher with a reputation for brilliance, and she fell in love with one of her colleagues. The divorce that followed was, for Lindy and her brother and sister, momentous. The three children grew up in the care and custody of their father. He made sure that they spent time every summer with their mother and never spoke unkindly of her. But Lindy always felt that she had grown up in the shadow of a scandal. At Smith College, she had a chance to forge a life of her own, and she saw in Mike Keiser a bright, creative spirit, someone whose energy and gusto she wanted to share, and also someone whose values were clear, traditional, and deeply rooted. She was a sophomore when he proposed to her, and she agreed to marry him, even though it meant interrupting her college career and signing on as the wife of a young naval officer. Given all the circumstances, their decision, both his and hers, might have seemed headstrong, but young as they were, their friends already saw them as a charmed couple whose marriage was built on attraction and bedrock commitment. They were two young people who knew their own minds. They were married in 1968. Mike, the son of a decorated pilot, had enlisted in the Navy. The Vietnam War was in its most intense, violent phase, and he was prepared to go wherever he was needed. He was trained in explosive ordnance demolition, in layman's language, defusing mines and bombs. As it turned out, he was stationed in Virginia Beach. The closest I got to Vietnam was Key West, and his at-sea duty was aboard a carrier in the Mediterranean, where he was in charge of a small detachment of men whose job was to look after the underwater portion of the huge ship. For most of his tour of duty, however, Mike was stateside. Lindy used her time in Virginia to finish her BS in chemistry at the College of William and Mary. Mike's college roommate, Phil Friedman, occasionally came to visit, and in 1971, immediately after Mike's discharge, Lindy and Mike spent the winter as ski bums in Vail. Phil came out for a 5-day visit. It was, in a way, the last hurrah of youth. Phil was scheduled to go to law school in the fall, and Mike planned to attend Harvard Business School, while Lindy had a job lined up in Cambridge. But one thing was becoming absolutely clear. Mike did not want to go back to school. I was thinking overtime about how to avoid grad school, and so was Phil, and we came up with the idea of selling something that was 100% recycled. It was a green idea, but none of us had a clue what went into the makings of a Christmas card. At the time, we thought of ourselves as ski bums, but we made our decision to go into business on April the 10th. We decided on Chicago because Phil was from there and had a friend who was a printer. By April 25th, we were incorporated, and we printed our first card in May. The press loved us, and the first story stressed the environmental aspect. Christmas cards for the ecologically concerned. Trash turned into greetings. There were lots of stories, but that first year we sold $60,000 worth of cards and barely broke even. We were operating out of a 2-room apartment, and Lindy had to take a job so that we could pay the rent. We were living on chili. Lindy was one of the founders of the company, but she went to work as a research assistant in Northwestern. The second year, RPG took in $300,000, and Phil and I made about $20,000 each. He was traveling and overseeing sales, and I mostly stayed here in Chicago, taking care of operations and selecting cards. The company really took off when we met Sandy Boynton. Artist Sandra Boynton was a young Yale renegade when she submitted her greeting card designs to RPG in 1973. Mike signed her up right away, and over the next 2 decades, she designed roughly 5,000 cards, recognizable for their whimsy and their cartoon animals. Her best-known card renders the usual birthday greeting as Hippo Birdie 2Us, and it has remained continuously in print since 1975, with 10 million copies sold. She was the artistic vehicle, engine, motor, call it what you will. We quickly went to $10 million in sales, and by the mid-80s, we were approaching $100 million. That made us the third largest greeting card company, and that's where we are today. But we're far, far behind the top two. Hallmark and American Greetings. RPG has a distinct identity now, thanks mostly to Sandy. We use the work of many other artists, but Sandy set the tone. People recognize our cards as witty and irreverent, not schmaltzy, sometimes slightly off-color, but with a kind of edgy humor. We have a special product, a differentiated product, what Hallmark thinks of as an alternative product, and that's all right with us. The headquarters of RPG is a 3-story brick building on a quiet street, 2 blocks from Wrigley Field. Erected in 1901, the building has a marble facade and many ornamental details, friezes, columns and cornices, but it was always intended for industrial use. With its squarish banks of frosted wire-reinforced windows, the place looks like a factory or perhaps a warehouse for a moving company. In fact, it was built for use as a dairy, shades of Mrs. O'Leary's cow, and Mike likes to show visitors the concrete ramps on which the cows move to different levels of the building. Obviously, no one has ever undertaken a significant modernization of this building. It is a far, far cry from a glistening downtown office tower. The only outward indication of RPG's presence is an unobtrusive sign over the glass door, showing the stylized, fully crowned tree that has long been the company logo. Inside, the 150 employees, RPG employs a total of 400 people, but most are at other locations across the country, are comfortably spread out, and the desks, chairs and tables appear to have been acquired at a fire sale. The priority at RPG is not on fancy furniture. Yet the workspaces had nearly all been individualized, turned into small, personal worlds marked by photos, posters, signs, banners, and all the other possessions that people use to define their space. The employees are a fair cross-section of the urban population in their cultural, ethnic, religious, and sexual diversity. The dress code seems to conform to the standards set by Chairman President Baron Keiser, though most employees keep their shoes on. It doesn't take a social scientist to see that the culture of this company is the exact opposite of the high-powered, high-gloss, high-stress corporations, in which the individual employee is expected to wear the company outfit, fit the company image, and toe the company line. Here at RPG, the ruling idea seems to be that people like to express themselves and that they will do their best work if given a chance to do so. The nerve centre of the operation is the art room, a windowless space adjacent to the office shared by Mike and Phil. The carpet is beige, the lighting is fluorescent, and a cigar store Indian stands in the corner. Canvas deck chairs are arranged around a long utility table. The walls have been fitted out with racks to hold several hundred cards, face out. Mike refers to the main wall as the bestseller wall, or the money wall. It shows, in rank order, the 100 top-selling birthday cards printed by RPG. A separate rack holds the bestsellers for other occasions and purposes. Each card is displayed with precise tracking information about the number of units shipped, the length of time it has been in circulation, its previous rank, and so on. It mirrors the taste of Americans on a daily basis, Mike says, and the information is of vital importance to the company since it enables RPG to keep its sales racks filled with proven sellers. The runaway success of RPG did not escape the attention of investment bankers. By the early 1980s, they began to call regularly on Mike and Phil, dangling enormous sums of money in front of them and urging them to venture into new realms of capitalism. Merger and acquisition types painted pictures of an empire with RPG at the centre, surrounded by a host of satellite companies. Make a widget that people want to buy. That's the essence of American capitalism, and that's what we knew how to do. It was tempting to think of starting new companies or building a conglomerate. I like to make things, but I'm not that interested in running them. The bankers were offering me a chance to do something big in business, but I eventually realized that my ambitions don't run along those lines. Companies don't last, fortunes don't last, but golf courses do. I'd made enough money to do what I wanted, and I wanted to build a golf course. Deep down, I wanted to build a golf course that people would be playing 500 years from now. In retrospect, I think the best decision I made was to say no to the investment bankers. They wanted me to diversify the company, but instead, I decided to diversify myself. Today, almost two decades later, that diversification is complete, though Mike and Lindy Keiser still live in Lincoln Park, a lively, affluent, close-in neighborhood on Chicago's north side where they have raised four children, Lee, Dana, Michael, and Christopher. The girls have begun their careers. Michael has just graduated from college, and Chris, the youngest by several years, is still in high school. The Keisers have been involved in all their children's activities, and now, Mike says, the centerpiece of our social life is Chris's basketball schedule. The four children grew up in a huge, rambling top-floor Lakeview apartment with ceilings high enough to play basketball. Yes, Mike did set up a hoop for the boys. The apartment is in a splendid Beaux Arts building and contains many features that evoke the style and luxury of the Gilded Age. Deeply recessed windows, elegant panelling, stately proportions, and renovations that are completely modern in spirit. A huge kitchen that opens into a recreation and game room. Conspicuously missing from the rec room, a mammoth television. There is a small one, and in a closet somewhere, there is a second, still smaller TV. But Mike and Lindy hate the boob tube. They have offered their children economic inducements not to watch. They are both readers, and there are books all over the apartment. Mike gets and reads four daily papers, as well as a number of financial and political newsletters, to satisfy his voracious appetite for news. The Keisers paid cash for their apartment. Another matter of old-fashioned principle. Neither of them likes debt. Lindy says, I feel better knowing that we own our home. No matter what happens, it's ours and no one can take it away. This is precisely the attitude that Mike has brought to all of his land purchases, including the purchase of the land at Bandon Dunes, and the money for the development of the golf course and resort. He paid cash. He paid cash for everything. Press him on the subject, as I did once, and he admits to having borrowed a few small sums for specific purchases, to help cash flow and to take advantage of low interest rates. But these were exceptions. He is clear about the benefits of paying cash. Once the money was spent, it was spent. I didn't have to think about it again. There was no one looking over my shoulder, no banker or investor harping at me to make a profit. Paying cash made it easier to do what I wanted. On the subject of money, there is one more thing that must be said about Mike and Lindy Keiser. They are extraordinarily generous. Years ago, Mike decided to give away half of his adjusted gross income, and he has tried to do so in ways that don't attract attention. He doesn't like to attend gala functions. He'd just as soon chew off his arm as don a tuxedo and go to a glittery dinner. But he does like to get down to ground level, to visit schools and hospitals and spend time with teachers, healers and activists. A note of enthusiasm enters Mike's voice when he speaks of the programs that he supports, and he puts aside all reserve when he talks about people like Mike Koldyke or Marva Collins or other people who are trying to make the world a better place. Now that three of his children are grown up and his golf courses are established, he estimates that his working hours are roughly divided into thirds. A third at RPG, a third on golf projects, and a third in charitable activities. Though he has usually resisted becoming a board member, he has willingly served on the boards of certain favourite institutions, like the Rehabilitation Institute of Chicago. I like to give money away. He told me on a day when I tagged along as he visited two Chicago charter schools he supports, and he certainly prefers aiding charities to acquiring possessions. He doesn't seem to own anything that he couldn't bear to part with. He drives a leased late-model Lincoln sedan whose main virtue, in his opinion, is that it is nondescript. I'm not a car guy, never have been. What I want from a car is no trouble. I really don't know what to say when people tell me about their new Beamer, especially people who are my age. Most guys get that out of their system by the time they're 30. The one luxury to which he does treat himself regularly is a private plane. RPG doesn't own a plane, but Mike is a good client of NetJets, a company that offers fractional aircraft ownership. In essence, NetJets is a top-quality charter service, and for years, Mike has made his business trips, including hundreds of trips from Chicago to the Oregon coast, in the cabin of a Citation X, the fastest jet in commercial use. But that is getting ahead of the story. In the mid-1980s, when Mike Keiser first felt the stirrings of an ambition to do something in golf, he didn't know exactly what that something might turn out to be. For years, he had been focused on building a family and building a company, and he simply hadn't had much time for golf. He played maybe 20 rounds a year, some of it business golf, some of it vacation golf, most of it on the public courses near Chicago. He actually played more tennis than golf, but for several years, during his lunch hour, he'd go jogging with a golf club in his hand, running from his office to a driving range about a mile away on Diversey Street. The club was always a driver, and he would hit a bucket of balls before jogging back to work. He became such a regular sight that newspaper columnist Mike Royko, who didn't know Mike Keiser from Adam, mentioned him as one of the sights of the city, wondering publicly what kind of nutcase carried a golf club when he jogged. This young, upwardly mobile, golf-deprived city dweller had a long way to go before he became a golf course developer and a visionary, a term that to this day makes him squirm. If anyone had told him in 1985 that he was at the beginning of a journey that would lead him to create the American Ballybunion on the Pacific coast, he would have been startled. Nothing in his experience suggested any such outcome. He'd never been to Oregon and had no plans to go. For that matter, he'd never laid eyes on Ballybunion or any of the other classic links courses of Scotland and Ireland. As a golf course developer, he was starting out pretty much from scratch. He had never invested in any kind of golf deal, and he wasn't even a member of a golf club. But golf was in his blood, and when he said no to the investment bankers dangling their schemes in front of him, he knew in a general way what direction he wanted to take. He was headed toward that shining, elusive realm known as the Kingdom of Golf. 3. The Lay of the Land. Variety is not only the spice of life, but it is the very foundation of golfing architecture. Diversity in nature is universal. Let your golfing architecture mirror it. An ideal or classical course demands variety, personality, and above all, the charm of romance. Charles Blair Macdonald, Scotland's Gift, Golf, 1928. As an intellectual discipline, golf architecture generally ranks far down the list. Only a few universities offer courses in golf architecture, where the subject is treated as a poor and distant cousin to landscape architecture. Most of the books on golf course design are handsome volumes, picture books intended to please the eye and entertain the armchair golfer. The serious, thoughtful books on the subject might fill a shelf or two, not a whole library. Unlike building architects, golf course designers do not have to follow a course of study, earn a degree, or take an exam in order to hang out their shingle. And given the nature of the game, in which the golfer is constantly assessing and evaluating the playing field as he attempts to negotiate its hazards, every golfer readily imagines that he too could easily become a golf course architect. At the very least, he knows he is fully entitled to criticize the fiend who actually did design the hole he just played. Fiend, or genius, or both. Golf course architects, as Mike began to learn, were often provocative and opinionated. He didn't try to educate himself in any systematic way, but as he made his way back into golf, playing as often as he could at Cog Hill and Jackson Park, two of Chicago's public courses, and eventually becoming a member at Butler National, Shoreacres, and Chicago Golf Club, he started to read about golf architecture, both in books and magazines. He also started to make regular winter golf trips with old school chums from Buffalo and friends from Chicago, visiting resorts in Florida and South Carolina, where he played courses created by the best contemporary designers. In the spring and summer, when he could steal away for a day or two, he often went to Philadelphia or New York, where he played classic courses like Merion, Pine Valley, and Shinnecock Hills. In 1986, he made a trip to Ireland, the first of many trips to explore the Lynx courses of the British Isles. In short, Mike was turning into a golf course buff. He loved to play, and on a good day he could still flirt with breaking 80, but his attitude toward the game was undergoing a change. He wanted to understand the whys and wherefores of golf design. What was the difference between a good hole and a bad one? Or, more crucially, between a good hole and a great one? What made one architect able to capture the right proportions and balance while another just missed? Why did so many old courses have such enduring appeal? In just a few years in the mid-1980s, Mike saw a huge variety of courses, from local munis to the most exclusive private clubs, from ancient British links to contemporary American stadium courses, from tricked-up resort tracks to the elegant classic courses that dominated the top 100 lists. He was gulping down golf course design in large doses, and his interest was more than academic. He was starting to look for property with the idea of building his own course, and he was ready to invest in golf development. And money is an effective intensifier. It gives an edge to any venture. Mike made a few unwise investments before buying property in Oregon, and his investment there was also one that most people in the golf industry would have considered pure folly. But by the time he bought his Oregon property, Mike had done his homework, and he knew what he needed to build a course that would capture the qualities of the great old designs. Perhaps the best way to convey the evolution of Mike's ambition is to outline the progress, if that is the right word, of golf design itself. Since the first designer, in the words of old Tom Morris, was the Almighty himself, it can be argued that all subsequent efforts to design a golf course are destined to fall far short of the original. The Lynx land, where golf was invented by the Scots, was not designed by the hand of man. Over eons, as coastal waters receded, the uncovered stretches that linked land and sea were shaped by the erosive forces of wind and tide. This sandy terrain was useful as a place for hardy sheep to graze. Their scrapings created further dings and dents in the land. We'll pass right over the welcome effect of their dung on the soil. The result of geology and grazing was a rugged, open, topsy-turvy plain of close-cropped grass, a space where it would naturally occur to a fellow, say a shepherd with a crook and hours of time on his hands, to figure out a cross-country game. That would be a gorf. At Musselburgh, Leith, Prestwick, St Andrews, Dornoch and other Scottish towns, the game soon evolved into a form recognisable today, and the only real task for the designer was to figure out where to place the holes. The number of holes varied from town to town. The links of Leith had 5 holes in a loop. Prestwick had 12. St Andrews originally had 22. And there were no generally shared standards of what a golf course ought to be. Because the links land was so endlessly undulating, and because the scale and shape of the undulations differed so widely from one town to the next, and finally because the designer lacked the means to alter the terrain in any significant way, the first golf courses were laid out with the idea of locating the holes so that the player had to overcome a set of interesting challenges as he propelled his ball from one hole to the next. These earliest golf holes were not built as much as they were discovered. The architect was usually also the golf professional, meaning that he made his living from the game. He gave lessons, made clubs and balls, and perhaps, like old Tom Morris at St Andrews, was also the keeper of the green, constantly tinkering with the turf, the bunkers, the tees and the greens, trying to keep the links in good order. If he had a sharp eye and the requisite sense of cunning, he soon had his own ideas about where to place a hole, about what obstacles and situations made for the most interesting play. The first links courses might have been primitive by our standards, but the close attention of the greenkeepers led to one refinement after another. As students of St Andrews know, a fellow like old Tom was occasionally willing to step in and make significant changes, like doubling the width of the corridors of play or reversing the order of the holes. The courses had firm, fast-playing surfaces, and with their treeless seaside locations, they were exposed to the winds that came whistling in. Links golf called for great skill in managing the ball in the winds, and for imagination in rolling it over and around the undulations of the terrain. The very nature of the ground lent itself to a variety of strategic challenges, as the irregularities of hollow and hillock, of bunker and knob, offered the player different paths to follow, according to his skill. From the beginning, golf was a difficult game, and on links courses, it hasn't become much easier. In fact, many of the great links courses, though they are now more than a century old, have endured with relatively minor changes. They present the same challenge to today's player as they did to the Scotsman armed only with his hickory sticks and his balls stuffed with goose feathers. The wind blows as hard as ever, and the modern golf ball bounds just as crazily over the landscape. It is one of the glories of golf that these old courses are still hale and hearty after all the years. The last word on links courses belongs to Dr. Alistair McKenzie, the golf course architect most often hailed as a genius. In 1933, in The Spirit of St. Andrews, he wrote, "I believe the real reason St. Andrews' old course is infinitely superior to anything else is owing to the fact that it was constructed when no one knew anything about the subject at all. And since then, it has been considered too sacred to be touched. What a pity it is that the natural advantages of many seaside courses have been neutralised by bad designing and construction work." The classic period of golf architecture extends roughly from 1900 to 1930 and coincides with America's discovery of golf. This country, prosperous and ready for serious leisure, caught the golf bug, and thousands of courses were built in the first 3 decades of the 20th century, a building boom that didn't end until the stock market crashed, and the hard times of the Great Depression stanched the flow of money. In Great Britain too, these years marked a period of expansion and creativity as homegrown architects cleverly adapted the principles of links golf to suit different kinds of terrain. Indeed, that was the great issue of the classic period. How could a golf architect preserve the character of the game on sites that did not have the inherent advantages found on links land? On moors and heathlands in England, on forests and farms in the United States, course designers sought to create holes that would present some of the same challenge and fascination as those on the links, and they came up with an astounding array of solutions to the problem. Most golf historians and most golfers who've been fortunate enough to play the classic courses believe that the architects at work during this period were especially gifted, and that their collective legacy is an array of golf holes unmatched for their originality, beauty, and variety. The classic era ended with a flourish of brilliance in the 1920s, a decade that is often called golf's golden age. Charles Blair Macdonald, a wealthy Chicagoan who had studied at St. Andrews, was the first American, perhaps the first person anywhere, to call himself a golf course architect. A big, blustery fellow with an ego the size of the Ritz, he was a skilled player, winner of the first official US amateur title in 1895, and the designer of the first 18-hole course in the country, the Chicago Golf Club. Yet he aspired to build another, more splendid course, an ideal course that would not only equal but surpass those of Great Britain, and he searched for years for a piece of ground that could serve his purpose. Finally, on Long Island on the shore of Siboney Bay, he found the place he was looking for and built the National Golf Links. When the course opened in 1912, the best golfers of the day, both British and American, agreed that the National fulfilled Macdonald's lofty ambitions. Macdonald had very deliberately copied several famous holes from the great links courses. The National had a Redan, patterned after the original Redan at North Berwick. It had an Eden, modelled after the hole at St. Andrews. It had an Alps, a Sahara, and a road hole, all with precedence across the Atlantic. On his trips to Great Britain, Macdonald had gathered surveyors' drawings of these holes. While he didn't slavishly reproduce them, he rejoiced in the discovery of a natural Redan, a natural Alps. Macdonald assumed that the character and quality of the land determined the character and quality of the golf holes that could be built upon it. He fretted mightily about the difficulties of remaining true to the spirit of the original Scottish holes, and his book, Scotland's Gift, Golf, contains a vigorous defence of his architectural principles. Always he insists on variety and diversity and the need to respect natural forms. He is appalled by the monstrosities created on many modern golf courses, which are a travesty on nature. No golfer can but shudder for the soul of golf. The prime importance of the site, the recreation of great holes from links courses, the emphasis on nature, the disdain for artificial features. These beliefs were, for Macdonald, the foundation of sound golf design. The success of the National Golf Links undoubtedly served as incentive to the elevation of the game in America, just as Macdonald hoped it would, and many architects followed his lead. Yet they didn't always share his view that the pedigree for a good golf hole had to be traced back to Scotland. On the contrary, the most talented architects of the classic era gave themselves great latitude to create. And this imaginative freedom resulted in the flowering of many different styles of design. The only limit to creativity was always the land itself. The classic designers had to work with the natural terrain for the very good reason that they couldn't transform it. The modern golf architect can call in the bulldozers whenever he wishes, but the architect of the 1920s had to depend on men with shovels and on horses or mules dragging heavy pans to smooth or shape the earth. To be sure, some courses were built at fabulous expense on sites that required transformation. Macdonald himself built a course called the Lido, which was an engineering marvel. This seaside site on the south shore of Long Island was transformed by 2 million cubic yards of sand, acquired by dredging the bottom of a channel, and the cost was $1,430,000, or about $40 million in today's dollars. But the best architects still believed that good land, undulating land, not steep but with pronounced topographical features, and with porous soils, not a heavy clay, was a sine qua non for a good golf course. Today, the best courses of the classic era are landmarks, and they seem to express perfectly the landscape from which they were conjured. At Pinehurst, Donald Ross, the prolific transplanted Scotsman who supervised the design and construction of some 400 courses around the United States, laboured for decades over his masterpiece, Pinehurst No. 2, a layout that captures the essence of the Carolina sandhills. On Long Island, A.W. Tillinghast, in his last hurrah, poured every ounce of his creativity and daring into Bethpage Black and made the forested site reveal its grandeur. In New Jersey, George Crump and his many advisers translated scrubby wastes into Pine Valley. In California, Jack Neville draped several golf holes on the cliffs above the surf and Pebble Beach was born. A few miles away, Alistair McKenzie went him one better, at least in terms of sheer daring and ethereal beauty, at Cypress Point. The boldness of these designers and their willingness to try something different, something grand and memorable, can hardly be overstated. The best architects of the era did indeed possess the classic design virtues of balance, harmony, and proportion, but they were not always restrained. Far from it. Many of the holes we admire today were boldly, even radically, innovative, and when built, they were the subject of intense controversy. When C.B. Macdonald wrote Scotland's Gift, Golf, he was clearly still smarting from some of the criticisms that had been levelled at him, and he wrote, "Sometimes it takes years to discover and appreciate hidden qualities which only time discloses. No real lover of golf with artistic understanding would undertake to measure the quality or fascination of golf by a yardstick, any more than a critic of poetry would attempt to measure the supreme sentiment expressed in a poem by the same method. One can understand the meter, but one cannot measure the soul expressed." In such passages, Macdonald lets us know that he does not regard golf as merely a game, nor golf architecture as merely the making of a game board. He saw golf design as an art, an attempt to speak to the highest aspirations and deepest emotions. Many other architects of the classic period, like Tillinghast and McKenzie, also have a great deal to say about the importance of beauty and the appeal of golf to the senses and the spirit. In 1927, in Golf Architecture in America, Its Strategy and Construction, George Thomas summed up the requirements for the profession. Thomas, the architect of Riviera, Bel Air, and many other California courses of the Golden Age, did not speak of technical skills, but of deeply human qualities. To learn golf architecture, one must know golf itself, its companionships, its joys, its sorrows, its battles. One must play golf and love it. The modern period of golf architecture begins after World War II, and it might as well be called the Age of Jones. Although his career began earlier, Robert Trent Jones was from 1950 to 1980 the most influential, most imitated, and most innovative architect on the golf scene. He was also, and by a wide margin, the most famous. To this day, his name is practically synonymous with the practice of golf course design in much the same way that Xerox is synonymous with the copying machine. Jones was the first architect who turned his name into a powerful brand, and his initials, RTJ, are recognized by...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.